Welcome to Agent of Wealth Podcast with Marc Bautis from Bautis Financial. In this podcast, Marc helps small business owners and retirees overcome the multiple wealth planning challenges involved in your financial life. We do this by creating comprehensive wealth management plans to guide you towards financial freedom, ensure you never run out of money, and help create a balance in life that prioritizes what is most important to you. Join us for this journey as Marc draws from years of expertise and guest experts to solve the multiple wealth planning issues involved in your financial life.
Hello and welcome to the Agent of Wealth podcast with Marc Bautis of Bautis Financial. Today we're talking about 2018 last chance planning, and this is actually part three of a series that Marc is doing for us. Good morning, Marc. How are you?
Good morning, Marc. I'm doing great. How are you?
Fantastic. Doing very, very well. I know this is part three, and I know there's more to come. What are we covering today?
Yeah, so today we're gonna cover any life changes that you may have gone through or may be thinking about. In our first two episodes, we covered areas of finance that you may want to look at with respect to your retirement, with respect to investments, and with respect to your health that you may want to consider taking any action before the end of the year. Mm-hmm. And today we're going to talk about life changes. And a lot of times I'll get asked, you know, who's a good person for you to work with, or who needs financial planning? And one of the areas that almost always necessitates some aspect of financial planning is when you do go through a life change. So we'll talk about some of what those changes are and what the planning activities may be when you go through one of them.
All right. So we have a list of some kind?
We do. Yeah. So we're gonna start out and you know, we could probably spend on each of these areas a full episode on it, but we're going to go cover some of the main points that you may want to consider. The first one we're going to start with is if someone's planning to buy or sell an asset like a home, a business, or a piece of real estate. Mm-hmm. And I think the area of it that comes up the most frequently is when someone plans to move. I see this a lot with retirees who may want to downsize for financial or non-financial reasons. But also families who are starting out, they start to have children. They may outgrow their first house or their starter house, and they want to look to upgrade into another house. And a lot of times I'll see people who would kind of do it blindly. They'll just say, okay, I think we want to move into this house, and really not look at the financial ramifications or what the financial impact is of making that change. Mm-hmm. So one thing I'll do is I'll recommend you run a side-by-side comparison between what your current situation is with what your house costs, what the mortgage is, the property tax, the home insurance, the what it costs to maintain it per year, and then project out what the new house will cost. Also taking into account that you may, you know, with the sale of the old house, you may either have money from that you're going to use as a down payment, or you may have to come up with some, you know, you may have to liquidate some assets somewhere else to pay for the down payment. And it's really, you know, seeing that side-by-side comparison, you can really look and see, okay, this is really going to impact me in a negative way or maybe a positive way, and it can help you make that decision. Hmm. And I've worked with a couple people recently who've done this. And in addition to that side-by-side on the, you know, looking at the balance sheet, looking at the cash flow, what I also like to do is look at how does this impact your goals. You know, if there is a change in cash flow, if you're going to be spending more per month on your house, or if you have to dip into a savings account or some other type of account to pay the down payment, you know, does it mean that you're not going to have enough to retire, you know, projected out, or that you may have to save more money to be able to afford to put your kids through college? And, you know, again, like I said, having those numbers staring at you in the face, it helps make that decision. You know, a lot of times retirees will hear, okay, I think I should downsize, I think I should sell. But, you know, when you factor in the closing cost, the moving cost, any taxes that they may have to pay on the gains of their house, it doesn't turn out to be actually any beneficial reason for doing it, at least financially. Mm-hmm. Now, there are obviously other reasons. You'll see some people want to move to somewhere where there's maybe less flights of stairs that they have to climb, or in a different location to be closer to family. So, you know, with all these changes that we're going to talk to, there's obviously a financial aspect to it, but there are definitely non-financial, emotional, decision that's part of it as well.
Absolutely. My wife and I have talked about that for quite a while. We love our home. Absolutely love our home. However, three flights of stairs is getting a little tiresome. a ranch might be nice.
That's true. So you do see that a lot as well.
But like you said, you've got to take the financial part of it into consideration. I mean, there's all sorts of different things with how much your down payment is on the next home, whether that you have PMI or don't have PMI. I mean, there's benefits and drawbacks to both. So, I mean, there's a lot to consider.
Definitely, and including the property taxes. I live in New Jersey, and it's a high property tax state, and you'll see people that want to move out of this area. Just the property tax savings alone are can be enormous. So there's a lot of different reasons for doing it, and you just have to take it into consideration.
Good points.
Yeah. All right, the next one we're going to cover is if you changed your job during the year, or even if you're planning to change your job. A lot of these checklists items with life changes, I think it's both, we want to look at it from the past, so did something happen, but also, and probably even better, is let's be proactive and say, are you planning to? Mm-hmm. And you know, that way at least it can help make that decision rather than being reactive and saying, okay, this happened, what do I mean, both are good areas to plan for, but you know, with everything, being proactive about it is probably a better way of doing it.
Sorry, question. How far in advance should somebody be thinking about that? If you're talking about the future, I want to change jobs in 6 months or a year or a year and a half, 2 years. How far in advance are you talking about them starting to plan that?
So I think, and it's probably not as far in advance as you would think. I've helped people. You know, they've looked into changing jobs. They've gotten an offer letter, and we've started the process of analyzing it, thinking about it right then and there. So it's not something that needs a lot of time. It doesn't have to be done. That analysis doesn't need a lot of time. It doesn't have to be planned out far in advance. You know, with anything, the further out you plan, probably the better it is, because you have more time to consider things. But it really doesn't have to be that far in advance. It can be, you know, a couple of days. It can be a week, and we can figure out what the impact is.
Okay, great.
Yeah. So, you know, just like the same thing we talked about with when you sell a house, you also want to look at the impact to your cash flow, balance sheet, when you change jobs. The non-financial piece, you want to look at what's the quality of life that's going to be changed, or is there going to be a quality of life change? I know helping someone look at this recently, they got an offer which was about a 30% increase in pay, and they turned it down because they felt that taking the new job, they were going to be away from the family for basically most of the day. They'd be gone before the sun comes up, you know, come home, everyone's asleep, and for the quality of life, they turned down the job. So, like everything, it's not all about money, all about financials, but you do want to take that into consideration as well. One of the areas when you do change a job is you have to figure out, okay, what am I going to do with my 401k plan or my retirement plan? You really have four options that you can do with it, and all retirement plans are different. Some are really good. Some are not so good. Some probably should be criminal the way they are.
Yeah.
But you really have to look at, you can keep your money in your old 401k. So after you move, you can keep it in your old 401k. You're not going to get a match anymore after you leave the company. If you did have a loan on your 401k, you'd have to pay that back. But some people just like their old 401k, they're comfortable with it, and that is an option. Or you can roll that into your new 401k. So you know we would do an analysis on your new 401k plan, look at what are the investment options, what are the plan expenses, the fees, and really make a determination, okay, should this money come into – should I roll it into the new 401k plan? And again, you're not going to get matched on this money that's coming over, or it's really just – If someone wants to consolidate and have it in one place, they could roll it into the new 401k plan. Or they can roll it into an IRA, which is common. And if you watch TV, I'm sure you've seen plenty of commercials about rolling over your old 401k into an IRA. Biggest difference with an IRA is really on the investment options, where you kind of have the limitless amount of options that you can invest in with an IRA. Usually you'll see with a 401k, you get a menu of options. Maybe there's 20 different funds you can invest in, and you know, you pick your allocations based off of those 20 funds. With an IRA, it's really, you know, if you want to buy Apple stock or some Canadian cannabis company, you can do that in your IRA. Or the fourth option, which is usually the nuclear or worst option, is taking it as a distribution. And really why this I say is the worst option is because tax – if your 401k was funded with pre-tax money, you'll have to pay tax on the distribution. And if you're younger than 59 and a half, there's a 10% penalty on the top of it that That's you right. have to pay. So, you know, some people – a distribution, it's something they can't get around. They need to do it. It just really has to be the last resort, or at least I recommend it be the last resort that you do for it.
Yep, and one of the things that you said about the loan, if you're looking to change jobs, a lot of people don't know that if you've taken a loan on your 401k, it's not that you have to repay it and you just keep making those payments. You have to pay that off within, 30 or 60 days?
Yeah, it is. So, yes, there's a – that's part of the consideration when you do initially take out that loan, just knowing, okay, I have a backup plan. If I change jobs, how can I get this loan paid back? Because, yes, you're right. It's a 60-day payback period where if you don't pay it back in 60 days, it's as if you took it as a distribution and the same rules apply. You'd pay tax and then also potentially that 10% penalty if you're younger than 59 and a half.
Ouch. Yeah. That could be big.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll move on to the next one, the next item in the checklist, which is, did you add to the family through birth or adoption? So obviously this is a good life change to go through, but raising children are very expensive. And Time Magazine recently did a study, and their analysis concluded that it cost about $233,000 to raise a child up to age 17. Unfortunately, once you get to age 17, most likely you're going to get hit with a college bill, which could, depending upon where your child goes to school, could be up to $500,000. So children are very expensive. The earlier you start planning for things, whether it's that raising them up, to that age 17, saving for college, it obviously the earlier you start is by far, it's the best decision or best approach to it. It's also when someone has a child, it's probably the biggest motivator I see for them to start doing some financial planning. Before we have children, we some of us want to do financial planning, but it's a lot of times that selfless approach or motto once we have a child, and that motivates us. So it's obviously a good thing. You also want to look into, you have a child, do you have enough life insurance? Is there enough disability that if something does happen to you, you're providing either spouse or both spouses, providing income that the family depends on. If that income went away due to a death or to disability, will the family continue to be able to move on or to be able to pay bills and live the same, standard of life that you guys were currently living? Mm-hmm. So that's part of it. And then probably the biggest part of, having a child, I think, is the estate planning aspect of it. And, I'll always recommend one of the things I first recommend when I meet with someone that has kids is make sure you have a will, put a will together. Recently, actually listened to a podcast from an estate attorney. And the title of the podcast was Estate Planning is Like Potty Training, which I thought was pretty interesting title. It got me to definitely listen to it. I have three kids. I also, work with people who go through estate planning and definitely could relate to both sides of it. And what the way he approached it was, he said, no one likes to think about either one, right? No one wants to think about death. Sometimes there's family drama that comes across, with when there is a death in the family. It's time consuming, to get your finances in order, so that you can go through with an estate, put together an estate plan, put together a will. On the potty training side, parents don't want to deal with it. Usually the child doesn't want to potty train, and their will is usually a lot stronger than their parents are. It's time consuming as well to do potty training, but it's something that you just have to do on both sides. You just put your estate plan together. You go through the potty training and you feel, a sense of accomplishment afterwards, a sense of relief after it. But it is, it's obviously challenging to do. It's hard, putting an estate plan together, putting a will together, it's a hard decision to make. And it's not necessarily the financial piece of the will that's hard. It's really the main reason for doing a will when you have a child is to name a guardian for that mm-hmm. child. And, I'll see a lot where parents will push it off. They don't want to make that decision. One spouse may think one person is better for to be the guardian, and while the other spouse may think it's someone else. And usually the advice I give is just, however the two spouses need to do it. Just pick someone for now. And it may change. The, you know, naming a guardian is not permanent. You can change it at any time. And if things change, you just change who the guardian is. But when you don't name a guardian, when you don't have a will, what happens is the state will pick. And, you know, they'll go through their criteria and they may pick the right person for the job or they may not. It may not be the person who you thought. It may not even be the two that the two spouses were debating about. Mm-hmm. It could be a third person that they decide on. So it's painful to get your will together, but it's definitely something that I recommend that we do.
Absolutely important. Definitely.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll move on to the next one. It's one that a lot of people don't think, I mean, it may not even necessarily impact you, but it does have an impact to your family. And that's if you have a child that recently graduates college. And, you know, keeping with the planning aspect for our kids, you know, estate planning, having a child, it doesn't stop there. We all want what's best for our kids. And really helping them get set up on the path of success after graduating college, they get a job, the earlier that they start making the better financial decisions, they'll be better off in the long run. So one and the areas of financial planning when someone graduates college, they're similar to what we all go through, you know, throughout life, but they're just looked at a different lens. I offer to sit down with the children of my clients who graduate college and really look at you know, a couple aspects of it and make sure they're doing the right thing. We'll look at, you know, the first thing is how to put a simple budget together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just with our financial habits or how we manage our finances, it's not really something that we learn in school. We don't learn it in grammar school, in high school, in college. So often either we pick up bad habits along the way or we learn good or bad habits from our parents. But it's an important skill to learn. It's an important thing to learn. So it definitely makes sense to spend some time with it. And on the budget, you know, we'll even start off with just simple ratios and say, okay, you're now getting a paycheck from your work, and we'll call it the 50-30-20 ratio, where we'll look at a budget and say, okay, of your paycheck, 50% of it should go to, we'll call it your mandatory expenses or your needs, you know, things like food, housing, utilities, health insurance, car payments, things like that, things that, you know, are going to be needed as living expenses. Mm-hmm. Then we'll look at the 30%, which we'll call them wants. So we'll call it the discretionary spending. So that could be shopping, dining out, hobbies, travel, things like that, that if they went away, you'd still be fine. You'd still be able to eat and have a place to live. And then 20%, we'll call it savings. So this could be retirement savings, savings for a house, savings for some other type of goal. But if you maintain, and you know, this is obviously a simple basic ratio, but if you maintain this ratio, you know, from day one that you start working, you'll be in a lot better shape than most of the people out there. So it seems simple, but it's something that can make a big difference with how your finances wind up over time.
Yeah, learning that discipline is incredibly important, and again, starting as early as possible, that's just going to help you out.
Yeah, and just with not just with new college graduates, but basically anyone. The other piece of financial planning or finances that I recommend is, you know, set yourself up. There's tons of apps out there. Technology has made great improvements where you have all the transparency and visibility into what's going on with your finances. So you should know what your credit score is. Mm-hmm. You know, all the time. You should know where your money is going, where, you know, what high level categories are you spending it on. And, you know, it sounds simple, but just seeing that, being able to visually look at it at any time, will definitely have a positive impact on your finances.
True.
Yeah. So, all right. So we'll move on to the next topic, which is, are you planning to retire? And obviously we can spend a lot of time on this, on what goes into planning to retire. But a couple of things that I wanted to cover at a high level, and what we'll do is in a future podcast, we'll really go into detail on what you should be doing, you know, 1 year, 5 years, even 10 years before retirement, the different milestones that you should be looking at. But let's say it's come to the time where you're making that decision whether you're going to retire. You know, there's the obvious piece where you want to make sure that the money that you've saved, whether it's in a retirement plan or money you have coming in from a pension or a Social Security, you want to make sure that that money can cover your finances year to year. But you also want to look at it as, okay, that transition into retirement, what am I going to do in retirement? What's going to occupy my time? Is there a hobby? Is there travel? Is there spending more time with grandchildren? T. Rowe Price came up with something where they it's almost called like a mock retirement, or it's basically a phased transition approach to retirement, where they call it practice in retirement. And it's essentially where you're still working, but also experiencing different aspects of retirement. And what we'll do is we'll go into detail in one of the future podcasts about what that means and how to plan for it, and where you'll be during this planned retirement, what you'll be spending. The benefit of doing it is you kind of get the lifestyle change. You get some feel for that of whether you're going to even want to be retired or semi-retired or fully retired. And also, where's your money going to come from to pay your expenses? So it's an interesting concept. Not very many people actually try it. It could definitely help making that decision of, am I ready to retire or not?
Got it.
Yeah. Those were the main checklist items that I wanted to cover. There are obviously a couple more. The theme is going to be common. You want to see how the change impacted, or is going to impact your finances. So, if you received a gift or inheritance, is there a severe illness in the family? Mm-hmm. Did you lose a loved one? Did you get married or end a marriage? You really want to look at, okay, is there the need for some type of planning that goes into, if you went through one of those life changes during the year? A lot of times I'll work with someone and we'll put a financial plan together. We'll meet, we'll go through a lot of stuff. And, they kind of assume, okay, I'm done, I'm good, there's nothing else I have to do. And the reality is we go through all these changes, maybe not all of them, but, every year these changes come up, and financial planning is really more about adjusting to the changes and analyzing what the impact is, helping that, using that analysis to make the decision whether to do this or to do that. Obviously, some of these things we cannot control. So some of them, yes, will be reactive, but even taking that approach of, okay, this life event happened or this life change happened, and how do I make the best decision to move forward from it? There are certain things that happen at the end of the year that make sense of, and some of them may happen at any time during the year, but really what this whole checklist was for was to just be something that you can look at and say, oh yes, this did happen, maybe in March it happened, but you didn't think about what the impact was or should you be doing anything. And really this looking at it once a year, looking at it at the end of the year, is really to help go through, really revisit what happened during the year and just make sure that you're doing the best things possible with your finances.
And that's the best thing, is that you can really mark this on your calendar and get this done every year. Review it with your advisor, seek them out if they're not seeking you out, and go over a few of these things that you've had happen or that are going to happen possibly in this next year. And the other thing that a lot of people don't think about is, even though we may not have certain changes in our life, other things around us may change, and you kind of alluded to that, but like Social Security rules and laws change and taxation laws change. If you're seeing some things, unless you want to do all the study and all the all the research on what those changes are, you need to be reaching out to someone like Mark or your advisor if you have one, to find out if that's going to affect you this year or this next year.
Yeah, definitely. Some of these changes are straightforward, but a lot of them are complex in determining whether there is an action to take. And, it comes down to really the time and the education or the knowledge. And if you don't have either of them, it definitely makes sense to reach out. My website, bautisfinancial.com, my contact info is there. There's even a link where you can schedule some time on my calendar to talk. I do have a copy of the checklist at bautisfinancial.com/checklist. If you want to take a look at it and see what items on there you may have gone through this year or you may want to look at with respect to financial planning. The only other thing in closing, if you enjoyed the podcast, please subscribe and leave a review.
Absolutely. And depending on when you listen to this, this is recorded, obviously, near the end of 2018, but you may just be finding this podcast, and you may be listening to this in March of 2019. It doesn't matter. Find a time to get a hold of Mark and talk about those things that you're going through, that you're looking forward to, or things that have happened in just this past few months that you have questions about. He'd be more than happy to answer them. Again, thank you for listening to the Agent of Wealth podcast with Marc Bautis. If you have not subscribed to the podcast yet, just like Marc said, please click the subscribe now button below. This way, when Marc comes out with a new podcast, it'll show up directly on your listening device. This makes it much easier to share these podcasts with your friends and family, and I'm thinking you probably know somebody that could use this advice. Again, thanks for listening. For everyone at Bautis Financial, this is Eric Johnson reminding you to live your best day every day. We'll see you next time.
Thank you for listening to the Agent of Wealth podcast. Click the subscribe button below to be notified when new episodes become available. The information covered and posted represents the views and opinions of the guest and does not necessarily represent the views or opinions of Bautis Financial. The content has been made available for informational and educational purposes only. The content is not intended to be a substitute for professional investing advice. Always seek the advice of your financial advisor or other qualified financial service provider with any questions you may have regarding your investment and financial planning.